welcome you to this session this afternoon on where we're going to discuss the Barilla Center for Food Nutrition, Nutritional Environmental Pyramid. You know, our lifestyles have a growing impact on the environmental equilibrium of our planet. In the food sector in particular, less sustainable models of consumption continue to emerge, so we're going almost in the wrong direction often. Considering that farming is actively responsible for producing 33% of the world's annual greenhouse gas emissions and absorbs approximately 70% of the water resources utilized by man, it's clear that we must re-examine our diet while also taking into consideration the ecological footprint of foods. From this perspective, the comparison of the traditional food pyramid of nutritional values with the new environmental pyramid in which every food is placed in terms of its impact on the planet has made it clear that the foods which are recommended to be eaten frequently are also less harmful from an ecological standpoint. So that's the good news. I think here today we have an exceptional panel to discuss this issue and move from how we represent the food pyramid to actually how we make it make a difference in the world, both in changing the consumption patterns, are we making progress, as well as can foods have a better environmental footprint. So we have here, my name is John Riley. I'm the co-director of the Joint Program on the Science and Policy of Global Change at MIT, and I'm a member of the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition Advisory Board. On my right, we have Eileen Kennedy, who's the former dean of the Friedman School of Nutrition and Science and Policy, and former director at USDA at the Center for Nutrition Policy and Promotion under the Clinton administration. We have Václav Smil, who's a distinguished professor of the Faculty of Environment and University at the University of Manitoba in Winnipeg, Canada. Kenneth Cook, who's co-founder and president of Environmental Working Group, an important group in the United States, been working for a combination of environmental and food nutrition in agricultural policy in the U.S., and Ricardo Valentini, who's a member of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, that group was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007, and he is a faculty member at the University of Tuscia. apologize for my poor Italian. So that's the discussion we're going to have today. I'm going to spend a few minutes introducing the double food pyramid. Formally, you may have heard about it in other sessions, but here you have a chance to see the what it's based on, and then we'll move to the speakers. So this is the double food pyramid. You'll see that the traditional food pyramid on the left, which emphasizes the need to eat vegetables and fruits, grains, and to limit our intake of things like sweets and beef, is the traditional food recommendation. On the right side is the inverted pyramid that links our food choices to the health of the planet. And there you'll see that what we're suggesting there is the bottom of the pyramid, which is inverted, is actually the has the biggest imprint on the planet. So red meat in particular has a very large ecological footprint, while fruits and vegetables and grains have a smaller environmental impact. So that's this story we mentioned at the opening, that in fact there's a large correlation between foods that we choose to make a healthier diet as well as a healthier planet. The methodology used is a life cycle assessment and a three footprint ecological footprints: carbon dioxide emissions and greenhouse gases, a water footprint, and an ecological footprint. So we're looking at the full life cycle impacts of these variety of products. That's why, beef. One of the reasons it has a very large footprint is that you're not only worried about the greenhouse gas emissions emitted in the production of beef, but also the fact that you're using grains to feed beef, and that has a bigger demand for land and resources and water. So it ends up being has a relatively large footprint, as you'll see as we go forward. Here's just some different water imprint footprints that are of interest. For example, the an egg uses 135 liters of water to produce for an egg, whereas a hamburger, 2,400 liters. So you can see the dramatic difference in water use implications of these food choices. Both a hamburger and an egg are good sources of protein, but in one case, the water implications are almost 20 times the other. This gives you the water pyramid, which is one element of the environmental pyramid. The environmental pyramid combines this water footprint sort of story. And again, we have foods arrayed from top to bottom. And again, you see the very large water imprint of food. These are, of course, averages around the globe. Some places do better or worse. And certainly a goal from the production side is to improve these footprints as we go forward, even as we try to change our diets toward less water-intensive foods. If we move to the carbon footprint, again, you see that the beef story is very at the very top, and fruits and vegetables down lower. So again, we have a strong correlation, probably not surprising, between the greenhouse gas footprint and the water footprint. If you use a lot of land and a lot of material in the input process, and it's relatively inefficient at producing, you know, basic material into a pound of food or a kilogram of food, it's going to have a bigger imprint throughout the system. Similarly, we can look at the ecological footprint, the number of the area demanded, used for these different commodities. As we go forward and we look at vanishing forests and vanishing natural ecosystems, if we rely on things like beef and cheese and butter that have a very large land imprint, that's going to kind of cause demand more land to be used for agriculture. Obviously, one of the challenges we face as the world goes forward is that the developing countries are moving to diets more like the Western country, with more beef and more meat products. It's important, of course, to have protein in your diet, and the idea of these pyramids is not to, you know, ban particular foods, but to let people have a good sense of what the choices are, and so they can make healthier choices both for the planet and for themselves.